Good morning, students. So we'll move on to the next topic of module number 3, that is optimizing IP for IoT. Fine. So in previous session, we discussed need for optimization, why we need to go for optimization, what are the different several reasons, okay, like which made us to go for optimizing the IP in different levels of the IoT architecture. Regarding that, we had a complete discussion. Okay, there we had a problem of problem regarding the devices, okay, and problem regarding the network, okay. So lot many other problems also we discussed, okay, like constrained devices, constrained network, okay, like IP supported devices, non-IP supported devices, okay. So those are all the problems which we must address. Now we'll go for optimizing IP for IoT topic. So here we'll be addressing some sort of solution which will lead us to go for implementing the IP concepts completely. Exactly. Okay. While the internet protocol is key for a successful internet of things, constrained nodes and constrained network mandate optimization at various layers and on multiple protocols of the IoT architecture. So as we know, if I want to go for a successful IoT network, okay, then we need to go for implementing the concepts of IP stack. Okay, but here we have the problem with the constrained devices and constrained nodes. Okay, so if you are resolving these two issues, then we can go for the successful IP architecture or successful IoT architecture. The following section introduces some of these optimization already available. So figure 5.1, okay, highlights the TCP IP layer where optimization is applied. Okay, so here just observe, we are having total 4 layers, is it right? Like transport layer we are having, network layer we have, then data link layer and physical layer we are having. Okay, so when it comes for physical layer, we are having an option like it may be wired or it may be wireless. Okay, and here we are not specifying what type of IEEE standard we are using, but when we are observing the data link layer, okay, so here we are using 802.14.4G, then 1415.4E such type. Okay, so we can easily identify by this your physical layer, okay, will also be working under 802 fashion. Okay, so I'd like to mention one more thing. So this 802 fashion, whatever we are having, IEEE 802 fashion, okay, so they are compatible with IPv4. They are compatible with IPv4 exactly. Okay, but just observe the network layer, okay, we are using IPv6 or IPv4 exactly. Okay, so whenever we are having a option of IPv4, so we don't have any issue with the package whatever we are generating from the network layer. Okay, and the same it will be forwarded by the data link layer and the physical layer. But just observe, we are having one more option, we call it as IPv6. Okay, if the packet is framed or if package is prepared, okay, based on IPv6 fashion, okay, then the frame format, the payload, whatever the fields we are involving in the data transmission, okay, everything will be increased exactly, but they cannot be handled by the data link layer and the physical layer. So what we need to do, we need to go for something called as a adaptation layer, who is responsible for converting this IPv6 fashion packets into a compatible packet which is supported by the data link layer and physical layer exactly. Okay, so this adaptation layer, whatever we are using, that will be extra. That is the optimization we are doing over here. Okay, fine. Then later, here we got one example. Okay, same type of example, 6LoWPAN we are having. Okay, and we need to optimize 6LoWPAN to 6Low exactly. Okay, there are two different versions. Okay, 6LoWPAN should be optimized for 6Low exactly. We'll see that how it can be done and all. In the IP architecture, the transport of IP packet over any given layer 1, that is physical layer, and layer 2, that is MAC layer, okay, protocol must be defined and documented. The model of packaging IP into lower layer protocol is often referred to as an adaptation layer. Exactly. Okay. So however it may be, whatever the package we are going to form or we are going to frame, okay, based on some like a supplement, okay, we are calling it as, okay, so that will be called as what? Adaptation layer. Exactly. The main example of adaptation layer optimized for constrained nodes or things are the ones under the 6-LoWPAN working group and its successor, the 6-LoWPAN working group. So we need to go for an optimization between 6-LoWPAN and 6-LoWPAN exactly. Okay, the initial focus of 6-LoWPAN working group was to optimize the transmission of IP packets or IPv6 packets over constrained networks such as IEEE 802.15.4. Okay, so here the thing is, the lower layer means the physical layer and the data link layer, who is using the standard of 802.15.4. okay, over that we need to transfer the IPv6 packets exactly. Okay, so we'll see that how we can do that. Okay, so figure 5.2 shows an example of an IoT protocol stack using the 6-LoWPAN adaptation layer beside the well-known IP protocol stack for reference. Okay, so here we can have a two different references over here. The left-hand side, the IP protocol stack, whatever we are having, so that will be the standard IP architecture exactly. Okay, you can observe we are having a Ethernet physical layer, Ethernet MAC layer. Okay, then later we'll be having a layer of IP, then later we'll be having a transport layer. Okay, then finally we are having a application layer like HTTP, RTP. Okay, see, such type of which is the standard. Okay, how many layers we are having? Just observe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 exactly. But when it comes for involving the adaptation layers, or when it comes for converting this the higher level version of a protocol into lower level version, okay, we need to go for some adaptation layers exactly. So we'll see that how the 6-LoWPAN, okay, whatever the architecture we are having, how, using that, how we can go for its successor 6-LoWPAN exactly. Okay, fine, we'll see that. So the application protocol we are having first layer, then the second layer we are having user datagram protocol. Okay, then the third layer, just observe, third layer actually it's supposed to be the IP layer exactly. Okay, fine, here what you are using, we are using IPv6 exactly, but just observe, above the data link layer and below the network layer, or between the network and data link layer, we are having one more sub layer, we are calling it as LoWPAN exactly. Okay, it states that we need to go for conversion of all the packets, whatever we are receiving from the higher layer, which belong to IPv6 version, should be converted for IPv4 version. Because just observe, IEEE 802.15.4 MAC, 802.15.4 physical layer we are using, because these two, data link layer and physical layer, are strictly compatible with IPv4 exactly. Then what we need to do? We need to go for optimizing adaptation layer between network and data link layer, so that we can have a conversion between IPv6 to IPv4 exactly. The 6-LoWPAN working group published RFC 4994, okay, which is foundational because it defines frame header for the capabilities of header compression, fragmentation and mesh addressing. So if I want to go for this type of conversion, like IPv6 to IPv4, okay, we need to go for total three different procedure, okay, which is referred by RFC. Okay, so here we need to concentrate about header compression. Okay, how we can go for compressing the header, because obvious, the packet whatever we are generating from IPv6, okay, is huge exactly. Okay, we will be using a heavy kind of fields, heavy kind of packet payload. Okay, the transmission rate using IPv6 will be more when we are comparing it to IPv4 exactly. Okay, so header compression should be done. Then if the packet size is huge, it should be fragmented, and the fragmented frame should be transmitted through the MAC layer and the physical layer. Then mesh addressing, it is just a kind of like broadcast. Okay, how many times we need to transfer it? Okay, how many times we need to transfer? Okay, because just observe here, we are going for a fragmentation, right? Okay, so if one packet which is of 10 MB, feel that we are having one packet which is of 10 MB, but it is not supported by mesh. Your data link layer and physical layer. So what we do, we'll be dividing it for 5 different packets exactly. Okay, so 5 different packets of 2, each packet of 2 MB exactly. Now just observe, source is same, destination is also same. Okay, 10 MB should be transmitted from source to destination, but what we do, we go for a procedure called a fragmentation, which should be divided, right? Okay, so now from the same source, same information should be transferred. Okay, but how many times? Total 5 times we need to transfer, so that we can transfer complete 10 MB exactly. Is it right? Okay, then mesh addressing means it indicates we are having one particular field which specifies that how many times we need to transfer. Okay, according to my example, 5 times exactly. Same source, same destination, same packet, but we are dividing it as a 5 pieces. 5 pieces should be transferred how many times? Total 5 times each. Okay, one packet should be transferred only once, but how many times? 5 times exactly. Okay, so then we go for the next topic, that is header compression. Okay, so you can observe over here, 6-low-pan header stacks, how it looks. If you are trying to involve, there are 3 frames. Okay, in first one we are having header compression itself, in second one we have fragment header. Okay, then header compression, both are included, but the third one, this is fully loaded exactly. Okay, mesh address header, okay, first thing it will be, then mesh addressing header, first thing, then fragment header, then IPv6 header compression. Okay, then the initially just observe we are having 802.15.4 header. Okay, at last we'll be having IPv6 payload exactly. So we are adding some extra bits or extra fields over here, because of which we can transfer the information for IPv6 version, that is 802.15.4. Okay, fine, we'll go for this header compression, how it will be done and all. So IPv6 header compression for 6-low-pan was defined initially with RFC 4944 and subsequently updated by RFC 6282 exactly. So initially first what we got, 4944 was the first version which introduced the header compression, but later we got updated by 6282 exactly. So this capability shrinks the size of IPv6 40 byte header and user datagram protocol UDP 8 byte header, okay, down as low as 6 byte combined in some cases. Okay, so total IPv6 we are having total 40 bytes of header, and for UDP we are having total 8 bytes. Total 48 bytes of header we are having if you want to transfer it for IPv6 network. Okay, but that will be compressed, okay, into only 6 byte. That will be compressed into only 6 byte exactly. Okay, note that header compression of 6-low-pan is only defined for an IPv6 header and not for IPv4. So this header compression, whatever technique we are using, that is dedicated only for IPv6, not for IPv4, remember. So here you can observe, see the first frame what we have, that is without header compression. Okay, without header compression. So you can observe the same format we are having. So 6-low-pan header, we are having 1 byte. Later, observe it very careful, IPv6 header 40 byte we are having, then UDP 8 bytes we are having, and what is the payload, what is the capacity of payload? 53 bytes exactly. Now what we are trying to do over here is this header we are having, right? So that we are trying to compress, just observe, we are going to compress this 40 plus 8 48 into total 6 bytes exactly. You can observe here, in the second frame format, okay, 2 bytes of header with compressed IPv6 header we are having. Okay, then later UDP of 4 byte exactly. 40 byte of IPv6 we are converting it as 2 byte, and 8 byte of UDP we are converting it as 4 byte exactly. Then the rest of the bytes, what we are making it as free, which is added for the payload. Okay, you can observe 53 we had. Okay, now it has increased to 108 exactly. Okay, so later. Then next we go for a fragmentation. What is this fragmentation? As I mentioned, if we are having a huge amount of information, so that should be break down into small pieces and it should be transferred. The maximum transmission unit, okay, MTU, for an IPv6 network must be at least 1,080 bytes. Okay, the term MTU defines the size of the largest protocol data unit that can be passed. For IEEE 802.15.4, 127 byte is the MTU. So you can observe the MTU for IPv6 network will be the total capacity of data transmission per transmission will be 1,280 exactly. But the MTU for the data link layer and physical layer, what we are using, 802.15.4 standard, which is having 127 byte. I can say like it is having around like 1050 almost 1050 bytes of difference we are having, is it right? So you can see that this is a problem, because IPv6 with a much longer MTU is carried inside the 802.15 frame with a much smaller one. To remedy this situation, a large IPv6 packet must be fragmented across multiple 802.15.4 frame, okay, at layer 2. The fragment header utilized by 6LoWPAN is composed of three primary fields: datagram size, datagram tag, and datagram offset. So here the payload or the complete packet we want to divide, okay, but here we are having three different fields which will guide us which packet is first or which fragment is first. Okay, so after how many bytes we are having a fragmentation, such type of information we will get over here. For that we are using datagram size, datagram tag, and datagram offset. The 1 byte datagram size feed specifies the total size of unfragmented payload, exactly, unfragmented payload. Okay, so that will be specified by datagram size exactly. Then datagram tag identifies the set of fragments for a payload. Okay, so how many set of fragments we are having? Like according to my example, 10 MB it was per 2 MB per fragment we are dividing. Okay, so total 5 exactly. So datagram tag will be 5 over here. Sorry, the datagram offset field delineates how far into a payload a particular fragment occurs. Okay, like after how many bytes, okay, we'll be having a fragmentation. Okay, that will be specified by the last one, that is the datagram offset exactly. So you can easily observe over here we are using 6 different field: 1 byte for datagram size, okay, then datagram tag, okay, how many fragments we are having for transmission, that will be identified. Then datagram offset, okay, like how far, like after how many bytes we are having a fragmentation, that will be identified exactly. So this is how we solve the header format, header compression, then fragmentation exactly. Then later, once we are done with dividing a complete payload into number of pieces, the overhead what we had for header limit or header frame, okay, so that also we overcome with what we are calling, it as, wait a second, the fragmentation, okay, the header compression, sorry, header compression, fragmentation, okay, and lastly we left with mesh addressing exactly. Okay, the purpose of the 6LoWPAN mesh addressing function is to forward package over multiple hops. Okay, three fields are defined for this header: hop limit, then source address, and destination address. As I mentioned, see, source and destination both are same. See, the target or else the source device want to communicate with the destination device, but with the fashion of IPv6. Then the packet size is huge over here, right? So what we do, we are dividing it to 5 different packets exactly. One packet will be divided as 5 different, but source and destination remain same exactly. So here, how many times we are going to transfer over here? Same packet, we are transferring it for 5 times, right? Actually, using IPv6 in one transition, we are transferring the complete 10 MB of information, but here we are breaking it into 2 exactly. So 2 MB packet, how many times we need to transfer? 5 times exactly. But destination to source, same it will be. So here we are having something called as a hop limit. Okay. Analogous to the IPv6 hop limit field, the hop limit for mesh addressing also provides an upper limit on how many times the frame can be forwarded. Okay, see, in my example, 5 times. Hop limit should be 5. Source address will be there, destination address will be there. So each hop decrements this value by 1 as it forwards. Okay, once the value hits 0, it is dropped and no longer forwarded. Okay, so here you can easily observe that 1 byte of 6LoWPAN mesh addressing header include hop count will be available. So this first 1 byte what we have, that indicates like how many times we need to transfer. Okay, the fragmented pieces of package, okay, how many times we need to transfer from where? From this source address, the second field of 2 byte what we have, that is the source address, then to where exactly? Destination address exactly. Okay, from source to destination we'll be having a different pieces of packet. How many times we need to transfer, that will be identified by your hop limit. Okay, once you are done with all the transmission, like every time we are transferring we are decrementing the value of this hop limit, then once it reaches the 0, okay, we are not, no, there will be no longer transition. Okay, so that will be the end of data transmission exactly. So this is how, if you are having the problem with IPv6 and IPv4 transition, okay, this can be handled or this can be overcome by these type of supplements exactly. Okay students, so this is it for now. So we'll meet with the next topic in next session. Thank you.